Belinda presents this unabridged recording from the Deltora Quest series, written by Emily Rodda and read by Ron Haddrick.
Deltora Quest 2, Book 3, The Shadowlands. Chapter 1, The Forbidden Way. The narrow tunnel through the rock disappeared into thick darkness, echoing with the hollow sound of lapping water. A broad band of bright pink and yellow seaweed floated across its entrance. Lief had no need to consult the little map in his hand to know that this grim tunnel was the Forbidden Way, the only path to the island of Keras and the third part of the Piran Pipe. But still he looked down at the map and the arrow drawn by the Piper of Auron. The map had been soaked, marked, and damaged, but against all odds it had survived. Like us, Lief thought, looking up at Jasmine and Barda. They were both sitting very still, staring at the dark crack in the rock. They no longer had to squint against stinging spray. The Auron guards, who were towing the boat, had ordered their great eels to slow. Because Auron boats were narrow, with no room for two to sit side by side, Barda was alone on the central seat, holding the boat's single paddle. Jasmine was at the front of the boat with Cree, whose injured wing was still weak, perched on her shoulder, and Feely chattering beneath her collar. Lief was in the back.
"Once we are in that tunnel, there will be no turning back," Barda muttered. "We will have to stay alert."
Lief nodded. Certainly, Doran the Dragon Lover, the first explorer of Deltora's underworld, had passed through the Forbidden Way. But that had been hundreds of years ago. Many things might have changed since then. As the boat's prow nudged the first strands of bright weed, the Auron guards released their hold and moved away. Only Pen, the Auron history keeper, stayed close beside the boat, speaking softly to the giant eel on whose neck she was perched. The guards were wild and fearsome, with their clothes of animal skin and wicked bone spears, but they would not cross that bright weed barrier, the ancient Auron warning of danger, unless ordered to do so by their leader, the Piper. And no such order had been given.
"We will give you a boat and guide you to the edge of our territory, but we can help you no further," the Piper had told Lief, Barda and Jasmine as they ate their final meal in Penn's little hut. "No Auron may enter the Forbidden Way."
"It is our most ancient law," added Penn, anxious to soften the Piper's bluntness. "Should Aurons enter their sea, the Kerans would attack."
"The Plume people said the same of you," Jasmine remarked lightly. "They said you would kill us on sight."
"The Plumes are lying savages," snapped the Piper, his eyes sparks of pale fire in his wrinkled face.
Lief and Barda glanced ruefully at one another. They knew that there was no point in defending the Plumes. The old hatred between the Piran tribes was too strong to be shaken by the arguments of three strangers. But Jasmine was looking at the two fighting spiders, sleeping peacefully together in their new large cage. United by fear of a common enemy, Flash and Fury had put aside their bitter rivalry and now wrestled only in play. As a result, they were to stay with Pen, who had grown quite fond of them despite their fearsome looks.
"Even Flash and Fury have decided they have more in common than they thought," Jasmine said. "But the Plumes, Aurons, and Kerans cling to their bitterness. It is hard to believe that once you were all Pirans."
"That was long ago," muttered the Piper. "Pirra is the Shadowlands now, and the Plumes and Kerans are to blame. If they had accepted the Lady Auron as Piper, the Piran Pipe would never have been divided, and the Shadow Lord would not have been able to take our land."
Penn's brow creased. She at least was clear-sighted enough to admit to herself that the followers of Auron had been just as stubborn as the followers of Auron's rivals, Plume and Keras. The three groups had shared equally in the rash decision to divide the Piran Pipe. Now, as the boat rocked gently in the swell caused by the coiling of the great eels, Lief looked up at Penn's anxious face. The history keeper had insisted on accompanying them as far as the Forbidden Way, carrying the fire that would light their torches. She had been cheerful on the journey through the Rainbow Sea, but now her fears showed clearly in her eyes. Holding her flare high, she urged her eel to the front of the boat and lit Jasmine's torch. Then, silently, she moved back to Lief. "Farewell, Penn," Lief said. "Thank you for all you've done for us." "I have done nothing," Penn answered, dipping the flare till it touched the torch Lief held up to her. "But what you have done for us can never be repaid. I pray that you..." She bowed her head, unable to continue.
"Never fear," said Barda heartily. "We will live to share mollusk patties with you again, Penn."
"I hope it will be so," Penn whispered. "May Auron protect you." She murmured to her eel, which obediently moved behind the boat and nudged it forward. The boat slipped over the band of weed and into the mouth of the tunnel. At once, Lief's mind filled with the sweet, piercing music of the Piran pipe. The sound was so loud, so overwhelming, that it seemed to him that Barda and Jasmine must surely be able to hear it too. But he could see by their faces that they could not. He stared, transfixed, into the darkness ahead. His mouth was dry, his head ringing with sound. Dimly, he realized that he was clutching the cloth bag that hung around his neck under his shirt. There, the mouthpiece and stem of the pipe lay hidden. The last piece of the pipe was calling to them out of the darkness. Calling. "Stop this. You must be alert. Be ready." Lief forced his hand over the side of the boat, scooped up some water, and dashed it into his face. He gasped as the icy liquid splashed on his hot skin. The spell was broken. The music faded away, leaving a strange, sad emptiness behind it. Lief blinked rapidly as his eyes cleared. The light was dimming rapidly. The walls of the passage were racing by. Lief twisted in his seat to look behind him and was startled to see that the passage entrance was already just a narrow slit of light in the distance. "What is happening?" Jasmine exclaimed. "Why are we going so fast?"
"Some sort of current is pulling us along," Barda called uneasily. "I am hardly paddling at all, and yet..."
"It is the pipe," Lief managed to say. I feel it." In moments, the boat was skimming along in darkness, the passage walls lit only by the flickering yellow light of the torches. The walls flashed with rainbow colors, which soon gave way to purest green. But above, where the torchlight did not reach, there was only thick black. Suddenly, Cree squawked as Jasmine jerked in her seat and slapped at her neck. "Something just fell on me," she exclaimed.
"A moth, no doubt," said Barda, concentrating on steering the boat as it raced along. "I have seen a few of them around."
Then he slapped at his own neck. Something had fallen onto the skin there and was clinging. Lief felt a tickling on his hand. He looked down and saw a winged, slug-like creature squirming there. He shook his hand, but the creature did not fall away. With a start, he realized that it was biting him, burrowing its head into his flesh, and it was growing. Its body was swelling as he watched, filling with his blood. "Leeches!" he shouted, shaking his hand again, filled with disgust. He saw Cree fluttering from Jasmine's shoulder as she scrabbled at the collar of her jacket, trying to pull off two leeches that were hanging from her neck. He saw with horror that more of the loathsome creatures had already landed on her hands.
"Beware above!" shouted Barda.
Lief looked, and his stomach heaved. The air high above them was teeming with flying leeches, streaming in thick, whirring clouds down from the darkness. Wildly, he waved the torch above his head. Dozens of slimy, winged bodies sizzled in the flames. But still, many of the leeches swerved around the fiery barrier to settle on his hands and arms, to feed and swell. And these were only the forerunners. Thousands upon thousands were following, spiraling downward. "Jasmine, Barda, get down!" Lief shouted. Recklessly, he cast his torch into the water, then tore off his cloak and threw it across the boat to make a canopy. In moments, the companions were lying face down beneath the cloak, holding it awkwardly in place. A pattering sound began as the first cloud of leeches rained down on their shelter, sensing the warm bodies beneath it. The pattering increased, became a relentless pounding. The cloak began to sag. Lief's arms and hands were trembling with the effort of holding the cloak in place. The leeches that had been clinging to him before he took shelter, and the few which had found a way to creep under the cloak since then, were hanging like bloated sausages from his wrists and the backs of his hands. He gritted his teeth, forcing down the wild, urgent need to pluck them off. The loaded cloak began pulling away from the boat's edge. Panic-stricken, Lief heaved at the fabric, trying to tug it back into place. But already leeches were pouring through the tiny gap, fastening onto his hands, slithering into his sleeve. The cloak bulged and slipped again. The gap at the side of the boat opened further. Leeches poured through in a whirring mass. "We are finished," Lief thought suddenly. "After all we've been through, we are lost. Defeated by the smallest creatures we have ever faced." It would have been almost funny if it had not been so vile. Even as his hands struggled hopelessly to close the gap, his mind flew to Del. He would never return. Marilyn's worst fears had come to pass. "Yet I regret nothing," Lief thought. "I did what I had to do." A strange peace flowed through him. And with that peace came the music of the Piran pipe, piercing him with its exquisite sweetness. At last, Lief surrendered himself to it. He let himself drift in the tides of sound. His eyes closed. And so it was that he did not notice that emerald light was suddenly shining through the fabric above his head. He did not notice that the drumming, pounding sound had ceased. He did not hear the soft splash of water as the boat skimmed lightly across a rippling green sea, drawn safely and surely to land. Chapter 2. Keras. When Lief came to himself, the voice of the pipe had faded and a great weight was pressing down on him. He pushed violently and at last struggled into dazzling emerald light. Then Barda and Jasmine stirred beside him. As they sat up, the boat tilted under the shifting weight of millions of dead leeches. The boat was rocking gently in shallow, pale green water that lapped on a sandy shore. Beyond the shore was a forest of fungus trees in soft greens and browns.
"We are on Keras," Barda said slowly. "We must have reached the end of the forbidden way. We came out into the light, and all the leeches died."
Suddenly shuddering, he scrambled out of the loaded boat, Jasmine and Lief close behind him. They plunged their arms and faces into the shining green water over and over again, as if to wash even the memory of the leeches away. When they felt clean again, they waded to shore, heaving the boat after them. They pulled the craft onto the gentle sloping sand and upturned it, emptying it of its vile cargo. Then Lief reclaimed his cloak, and they moved on into the green shade of the forest. A sandy path wound through the trees. They began to follow it. Now and then there was the sound of a creature scuttling in the sand, but there was no other sign of life. The silence was eerie.
"So we are in the territory of the Emerald," Barda said in a casual but very loud voice. "Above us is Dread Mountain, where our friends the Dread Gnomes live."
Lief realized that Barda was telling any unseen watchers to be wary of attacking them. Barda sensed, as he did, that the forest was not as deserted as it seemed. They reached a clearing closely hemmed in by trees. Here the silence seemed thicker. The back of Lief's neck prickled. He looked rapidly around, but nothing stirred. Jasmine's eyes flicked down to the great gems that studded the belt at Leaf's waist. The ruby and the emerald were undimmed.
"The gems cannot be relied upon to give warning down here," Barda muttered.
"So you have told me," said Jasmine. "But why is it so? The gems first came from deep within Deltora. Surely they should be more powerful here, not less."
"Who are you? Why are you here?"
The companions jumped back, drawing their weapons. The whispering voice.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.